I just wanted to spin into the frame.
Is that what you were doing? I can't stand you. Is that a tambourine? What's wrong with you, dude?
I got too much stuff in this office, man. I got a lot of toys in here.
Got the beat laboratory.
Hey, but you know what? That was the perfect setup for an only child episode.
That's true.
An only child would do. Yeah.
Damn, I wish we could get that corner of your office right now with mad toys in it.
I mean, we could go mobile one day.
Yeah, you gotta take a picture of that joint and post it.
Praise the teachers who dealt with us. Yeah.
Yeah, nah, we was annoying. We used to come to school hype. Other kids are there.
Yeah. It's a beautiful thing to have little school friends that you're not in Fight Club with.
I still can't believe you were in Fight Club. That's the most ridiculous thing I've ever heard.
And so I feel like we should cut the music and just jump out here and talk about your new dude. Because we'll just come on this visual.
Oh, for those, whatever.
For those of you who are in our listening community and not in our visual community on YouTube, talking to one specific person who I know has not visually looked at us yet. But, oh, let's intro. My bad. You want to go? Do you want me to try my radio intro?
Welcome to the Lunch Break Podcast, episode 13. We have an update. We got a couple great things off the last episode. Amazing feedback. It's a joyous occasion for us. High energy, very excited. Tell us what we're updating, Zan.
Well, so Stu often comes in here with his anchorman broadcasting voice. So I have an intro that I wanted to try too.
You
ready? You ready for it? Let me turn around again in my chair and spin. Good morning, good afternoon, and good evening. Welcome to the Lunch Break Podcast, episode 13. You're now tuned in, hearing us through your headphones, the mellifluously cacophonous sounds of Stewie C and Zanny T on the radio.
That was amazing.
What was Samuel Jackson's name and Do the Right Thing? Brother.
I want to say Brother Black, but that's not it.
No, that's not Brother. But shout out to Brother Haroon Black. I hope he's still alive. And if he's not, man, may his eternal soul rest in peace, man. That guy
Brother Black was the man.
So, all right, we're all over the place, and I will give you all the update that Stuart was trying to allude to before I needed to get my anchor man on.
Nah, your intro is way better.
So our brother Riyan has had his time modified.
Yes.
Like, that's just, I felt you were reaching for the board or something. So, yeah, I'll pause for that.
Yep, there you go.
So, Riyan, as of yesterday, or my apologies, I spoke to Riyan on Thursday last. And on Thursday, he was in expectation that by Friday, he would be out of prison. I have not heard from him. We are recording on Saturday. Either way, he knows for certain that his time has been modified. His release is imminent and he will be coming home soon. So yesterday I was at FedEx shipping him a bunch of pieces for my clothing brand, shipping him my brand new sneakers that I did get for myself. And God moved me in a direction to say, man, you've got enough pairs of shoes. Give this guy the brand new thing so he can have whatever, you know, just being fresh out and actually having the newest thing out just felt symbolic to me. And we used to share sneakers, right? I forgot that we wore the same size shoes. And he said that his homegirl, and forgive me if I'm misappropriately naming what y'all's relationship is, but I don't know everybody's details.
You make sure so I turn just, that in. Look, yeah, I'm just saying.
That's all I'm saying. So his girl, Neek, who has been helping us out and serving as a great conduit between me and Riyan and communicating with us in advance of him coming on and doing the pod last week. So, he was telling me that she was watching a podcast and she said, like, man, your brother must have like 500 pairs of shoes behind him. And I was like, well, let's be
not that many.
Like, these perceptions are a little off, even though I came in looking super Hollywood today. But yeah, so it was one of those things where I'm like, man, I've got enough shoes, obviously, from those of you who are in our visual community. So I just really wanted to give them the fresh of the fresh. So I gave him those Reimagined threes and about 14, 15 different pieces from the brand, man. So I'm ecstatic when he comes home that I just want to see
Drake.
Him. That's just like, out of all of that, you know, I wrote in the package that these are glory garments and I wrote a letter to him that I can't wait to deliver by hand this time, because all the last letters and the letter that we talked about in the last podcast, those were delivered to him in some, as we said, arduous and egregious circumstances. So now to hand deliver and really, really bless him in our conversations as he goes and looks forward, that's going to be dope. So I'm hoping to go see him in the next 2 weeks. He said he can't wait to shake your hand. Oh, Stu said, I forget that, that handshake. Stu said he's going to get a hug from him. So
yeah,
a
handshake is OD. But yeah, I mean.
Yeah, I mean, I blabbed a bit about that. But how'd you feel when I was sharing the news with you this week, man?
I mean, again, I mean, when we were recording last week, I had to take a second, man, and just kind of, because I was emotionally, that was a lot to take in. And, you know, it definitely put into perspective the advantages, the blessings, the just the framework of just looking at, you know, what you and I have survived as human beings, as Black men in this country. And just, you know, it just made me so much more grateful. It was a very humbling experience. And yeah, it just put a lot of things into context for me, man. And I mean, just to get that news, because again, the whole time we're having this conversation, and I think I said this to you before, you know, I could tell that he was trying not to put too much into what the hearing was going to be, because mm-hmm. if it had gone another way, you mm-hmm. know, he still had to maintain, you know, his strength mentally. Yeah. But to get that that we got the desired outcome and desired results, and that he is going to be a free man. You know, I thought about all of the very simple things that he wanted for his life when he got out, to go see mm-hmm. his grandma, to be able to open the front door and step outside, and to not be policed for everything or monitored for everything he did. You know, he's going to get to have some solitude. You don't get that in prison, for real. Not in a way that's healthy anyway. So I'm very excited.
And if you get
for him.
Solitude, you're not getting solace, which are different
that's,
things.
That's absolutely really correct. You're right. And solace is the word. You got it.
And all of that is incredible. What we've talked about a bit as you and I were communicating via text throughout the week about my excitement and all that. And y'all, I had to take a beat a couple times, like Stu said, even after recording last Saturday, it was just walk outside and enjoy the sunshine on your face and the simple freedoms and joys we have in life that Riyan did not have and will soon get to return to. And as I was talking to Riyan this week, that's what we were saying. Like, look, man, I was trying to help manage his expectations a little bit.
Yeah.
Like, hey, you know, my dad got out during the pandemic. And while we're still very much in the aftermath of the pandemic right now, things have changed. And not only has the world progressed, of course, that he recognized in the last 17 years, but it's just a very different time. So I don't want you to think that everything's going to come immediately. And just all those things mm-hmm. that you want to talk about to make sure that their head is where it needs to be as they face a world that looks like our world today. It's overwhelming. It's overstimulating and it's aggressive in many ways that we had not experienced. And maybe this actually helps to set us up to the conversation today, because when we were kids, it's a way different world than when we were kids. And Riyan went to jail when he was a kid. And while you get to interact with technology in certain ways, they have tablets. Like, it's not like he's just a dinosaur and hasn't touched things. And again, he's a student. So through his interactions with the University of Baltimore, he's getting some of this, but it's not the same as experiential. So, to backtrack, I'm expecting and looking forward to all the things that we're going to have together as brothers now that he's free. But going back to the kid I was and the kid that he encountered, and that's what made me think, hey, man, what do you think about doing this only child episode? Because I wouldn't have been as close to Riyan as I was if I had my own brother or I had some other siblings in the home. I went outside and sought what other people had in friendship and in brotherhood by going outside the home. So me and Stu were realizing, well, we got another one of those episodes where we can talk about similarities, because we were both only children. Stu, after a certain point, right, you inherited step siblings and such. But that's such a unique experience, and it comes with a lot of stereotypes against it, preconceived notions and biases. And as we've noted before, we want to be that podcast to come in here and demystify and debunk some of those things. So it'll be a good opportunity to talk about what is it like to be only children. What is it like to be friends, and how the only child thing drove our brotherhood? I think it might even be cool to talk about some of the annoyances in our various only child actions that we have, like behaviors that annoys you. And it's like, man, you know, maybe I was good to be an only child, because I don't know if I could have had this in the same home every day.
It's true. Yeah, I mean, man, I think a lot of the way that I show love to you as my brother, to Austin, to Mike, to, you know, to Aaron, to a lot of the brothers in our circle, that energy comes from that inner child that so badly wanted to have siblings. You know, I could throw Janelle in that mix. I can throw Autumn in that mix. for me, it was really tough being an only child. Like, I had a sick parent, like, growing up. You know, I can count on one hand how many times I've seen my mom actually help, like, healthy and, like, joyful. But for most of my childhood, you know, I spent a lot of time being her support system. And that's rough on a kid just by yourself. I mean, I think we talked about that a lot, you know, just being, especially when you're older, having to take care of your parents. And it's just you know what I'm saying? And I think that a lot of how I interact with, like, your mom and Mike's mom and Austin's family and parents, comes from, you know, that state where it's like, hey, I'm here with you. You know what I'm saying? I don't want you to feel like you only have yourself to count on should something happen with your parents. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
That's very top of mind for me. I think about that quite a bit, that, you know, how to support you all when your main parental figure, you know, should leave this earth. Like, how can I be a support system? How can I be a structured, you know, backer of your emotional support? Because I've been through it. And I know what it's like, and I know it's tough when you have to do it by yourself.
Yeah, and you kind of touched a lot there. I'm thinking, so there's the distinction between the only child in childhood and then the adult offspring is still the sole offspring of that individual, right? And then the responsibilities, I'll call them, are different in those two phases of life. So as a child, often I'm thinking only child, and you wanted siblings. I don't know that I necessarily wanted siblings when I was a kid. because as a kid, right, that the early stage of only childhood, you're getting attention. Mm-hmm. You are, and hopefully you're getting attention, and it looks different, and I'll get to it eventually, but I got too much attention in some ways. Mm-hmm. And I'll talk about how that was more so detrimental or more burdensome for me. But you get the attention, you get resourcing, especially as the only child of a single parent. Right. I don't know what that would have looked like if my mom had to spread that finite amount of love that I'm only getting from one parent around more children. But then you have that adulthood, right? And that adulthood comes with different responsibilities. And then to your point of how you've been serving me as a brother over the years is, well, it's hard to care for a parent by yourself when they start having adult parent issues. And we know in the Black community, it looks way different than what it would look like for other communities, specifically even socioeconomic status at times. We know that people of color are more likely to take care of their adult parents. And that's not to say that you and I necessarily do that, but it's just one of those things that we have to think about culturally of how we show up for our friends who are going through only childhood, right? It looks different when you're handling those burdens that everybody does of this, like taking care of their parents as they age and what elder care may look like. And then you add that layer of cultural context and it creates different complexities. So it has changed in adulthood. I'm with you, right? Like, or having to be the person to say, mom, dad, have you called the doctor? Have you followed up on that type of thing? It's different if you had that love to spread around other people.
Right.
Another thing that comes to mind for me is that partnership makes that easier though.
I agree.
And having a partner that can, and that's when I started to see the value of that differently over the years. Like, oh, does my mom interact with girlfriend, wife, blah, 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 right? Like it's over the years, are you looking at how that can be helpful and even how that can have just someone to share what you're going through? Because you spend your entire life like, well, if mom has a bad day, if dad did something exciting, I can't share any of those things with anyone else. It's just all on me. And maybe we'll get into that monologue thing a little later from that. But so, all right. What made you want siblings as a kid?
Man, look, as a kid, I mean,
like sharing. I like sharing. You are not the right type of only kid, man. No, we're on two different sides of that.
I'm very different when it comes to that. And, you know, part of that is upbringing. Part of that is, you know, as a child, and it's something that I've had to kind of combat in therapy, right? I was alone a lot as a kid. Like I spent a lot of time by myself. So, I mean, I often joke, I could talk to a wall. Like, I talked to myself as a kid.
All right. We're here now. We've got to be in this space. All right. So two things on that. Yes. I believe we are just two examples of only children, but I believe it is true for the entire panorama of only children that alone time, that's a little bit of hyperbole, right? But I would assume the majority of only children do value alone time in a different way than people who grew up in a home with others. But I can also understand how if you grew up in a space with many other people, you might crave alone time because you didn't have the opportunity to. So maybe even the way that we use alone time may differ. But personally, and you know this to be true of me, I need abundant alone time. Because I am so in my head because I've sat with my thoughts for X amount of years just by myself. And if you're an only child of a working parent, right, you're spending even more time alone as a latchkey kid or whatever that may look like, or alone with the television to which you wanted to talk about.
Yes.
You you have no one else to talk to. And then if you're watching, you know me, I like to pause and talk about the show and the thing that's happening in it. Right? So you're talking to yourself. And
you still do that, by the way. You'll watch something like, and text me like, yo, have you seen?
gotta talk. So you're a kid. Yeah. And then you add the layer of back to being when we were young, gifted, and Black, you add that giftedness into it and you have all of these things that you want to express.
That's right.
And you need an outlet for it, but you don't have siblings. Your parents not at home. If you're not outside in the streets, because oftentimes your parents not home, but you can't be in the street with anybody else. Your parents still expects you to be home. Yes. So it's just you're by yourself. And what do you do with all of that time? And I'd like to believe we were good kids. So we were just by ourselves, just consuming info and nerding out on things and didn't have anybody to nerd out with.
Yeah. I think that's part of the reason why we connected because we were, while character trait wise, we are different as it pertains to, obviously I'm a sharer. I have this big obnoxious personality.
I share. Like,
that's not that you, like, I overshare. How about
food,
that?
Like,
no, absolutely. Okay. So for the people that have been around us or have known us for many years, Zan is not a big sharer of food because he is a very calculated eater. One, he's very conscious of what he puts in his body. That's number one. Number two, he takes small bites of every portion of his plate and calculates that
in rounds.
So that in rounds, right? And so at the end of his meal, there is a little bit of every portion of his dish and he has to consume it that way.
Yeah,
I mean,
I have OCD,
Zan OCD moment.
it's how my brain processes. So either way, let's get off of my little weird stuff. But so you like sharing, you were talking about those traits and being brought up in certain ways. So keep going. Sorry.
Yeah, no, I mean, I think that's part of why we kind of saw a lot of ourselves in one another. But
wanting to nerd out together.
Yeah. You know what I'm saying? I've always kind of craved that having that person. I mean, because you asked the question, you know, what made you want to have siblings? And it was like, I mean, again, just someone to talk to, someone to share these notions and, you know, kind of have a dialogue on things that we would be experiencing in real time. You know what I'm saying? Like a lot of, you know, sense of humor, you know, comes from what we watched and what we consumed from a content standpoint as children. And I can't imagine that children today feel as alone, quote unquote, as we did when we were kids, because they have so many different tools that makes them not feel
that,
as alone.
Well, let me ask this. What tools are you talking about? Like social media?
Yeah, I mean, like social media. I mean, the internet. I mean, there's so many things that...
Dude, don't make us sound like we didn't. So I think this is important. So for a good portion of our only childhood, we at least had T9 texting. Like the high school years when you really do need to connect, I could text message in high school. So I don't feel like we had no... Like, you know, we're that generation where we bridged the gap. We didn't have... Well, I guess we had AIM. I didn't have a computer in my home growing up, so I didn't get to...
I bought the computer in my home.
Right, see, look, and you had abundant time to do it because you had no other siblings.
That's right.
Well, I was at the Reynoldstown Library getting mine in. I think we connected in different ways. I still think the avenues of now there it's facilitated certainly nowadays with social media, but I'd like to believe we had enough avenues to connect with friends. So I think only children, I don't know the only children today have it easier than us. I'm not willing to say that
I'm not saying
that for them.
I'm not saying it's easier. I'm saying, I'm more so saying it's different because when we were kids, I'm not even talking about social media. I'm saying the advancement of technology, the fact that you could be watching something and text your friend, like, yo, those thoughts, That's different. That's different than what we had. We had to wait. Yes. We had to wait when we saw something on TV. Go to school. Have that conversation. Like it's just different.
No, I used the house phone, bro. I used the house phone.
I never really called people like that, bro. I would call
Riyan. Yeah, I would call Riyan and be like, "Yo, did you see?" Like, yeah, I actually, and I had a house phone when I was five, my own line. So that's an important thing. Difference.
I didn't have that.
Yeah, my mom gave me my own line at 5 years old.
I had cable in my room. I thought that was like,
oh yeah, cable in the room was also rocking. Whether or not that cable was legal is different. But hey, we had what we had. Love that black box back then.
You said too much.
So the statute of limitations is over.
I mean, it's a done deal.
No, it's probably a Comcast bill floating around out there right now. Got him. Open and shut case, Johnson. So
sprinkle a little bit. Get out of here.
See? And those are things that we watch on television. Exactly. So exactly. We just quote that stuff all day. But I did call Riyan and called other friends on the phone to connect. But I think
in high school, I probably spent more time on the phone than I did when I was younger. I'm thinking like pre-Maryland, like when I was like.
So, I have a photo of me on the phone at like five in a big wicker chair. Yeah. I think you've seen it before, right? Like
I have absolutely seen that.
I had a little hotline going, man.
Yeah.
But
when I think about it,
I don't know. I don't think it is. I think it was black. I'm picturing a black one right now. It's not important in this moment. But when I think about, so you were talking about the friend aspect and contacting your friend to talk about what you're engaging with in the home because you're an only child. But what I thought about is how do you make friends as an only child? And even the fact that you have friends, and I've thought before about what would it look like. I think that I can make friends fairly easily, although I'm extremely introverted. I don't have a problem connecting with people in my adulthood because I always had to exit my home to connect with people in my childhood. So I didn't have any other choice, right? If I wanted to engage with people, I had to go out and meet them and bring them into my world or embed myself into their world so that I could have other people to talk to besides my mom, me, and the walls. And whatever my Ninja Turtles I was playing with at the time. So like that type of thing, weirdo. But and to that point of being an only child and how much I honor my inner child, I have a Raphael Ninja Turtle in my office and all of those toys, and I buy you toys all the time, right? It's like, man, like we were children, and some of that, the only child thing for both of us had an end of innocence at a certain early point for different reasons.
Absolutely.
So agree, even within this idea of being an only child, it's just the concept of childhood. And I don't feel like I was childlike or a child for very long. And similarly, losing your mom at 13, I'd imagine shifted your childhood in a way that the inner child who also was an inner only child was not a child for as long as you would have hoped.
Absolutely. It's why I love sneakers so much, right? Because I when I was a kid, there were certain things I just couldn't get, you know, it's the reason why I still play video games. It allows for me to connect with my inner child. Right. Mm-hmm. And I think that I agree with that. I don't know that I've given that as much thought as you just so eloquently, stated, but, I think when you are an only child, it does, you get to a certain point where you have to grow up a little bit earlier than all the other children that may have siblings that may be able to kind of shield them, either older siblings that shield them a little bit, or maybe you've learned from their mistakes or whatever it may be. But I think that we connect to our inner child a lot more because we did feel like that time was a lot shorter than we would have liked.
Yeah. And you know what you just made me think about? All only children are eldest children until they're not. Right.
Yes.
What I mean by that is
that's true.
As far as we knew, we were just going to be the oldest child until it came a point where we just didn't have a sibling. It's I'm the only child. It's something I never thought about, but it's like, I was the eldest until I was not.
Yes.
But
I got an older sister. Like, I mean,
and then that's also extremely unique or adds a layer of nuance to the only child aspect, because similarly, I'm an only child. I'm my mother's only child, but I do have half siblings. Same. Now, I never got to establish a relationship with them early. My sister, who recently passed away, I didn't meet her until I was 16. So I was raised and grown by then, in my point, right? I was going to college a year later. So that idea of interacting with and having shared experience with someone else under the parentage of the same people, I just have no clue what that looks like. And it's I used to envy it, right? You see these big families on television, you know, and the American nuclear family unit was what they always pushed on us, right? Even when they got rid of little Judy on Family Matters, right? It's like, well, they still got other siblings, right? Yeah, but you see, so you've got
Fresh Prince, though. That was weird.
Yeah, they did. Like, and blended family, right? You brought in Rachel's kid. We're just talking about every show we watched on ABC in the 90s. But so while we're doing it, let's keep it rolling with that TGIF. So
did they get rid of the sister from Boy Meets World after a certain point?
No, Morgan stayed on there, but she just I don't know if she switched
actresses.
Yeah, that's what it is. There was a different Morgan, the less cute one. But like, dude, even Sean had a brother. Remember when Sean's brother Jack? I watched that show way too long.
Matthew Lawrence, bro, I know.
The Lawrence brothers, even the Lawrence brothers ruled TV. See, everybody had a brother, man. Yeah, the Jonas brothers,
Joey, Matthew, and Andy. Yes,
sure. I'm not about to spend our time today on this podcast bigging up the Lawrence brothers.
I'm not bigging them up. I'm just trying to remember.
See, but that, you know, and that's an interesting thing too. And we were going to talk about this later.
Blossom.
So, yeah, Blossom was Blossom was kind of cool, man. There was style in that show.
and then Six was on the Parkers.
She was, yeah.
Her she was.
What was her name?
She's Kim's best friend. I don't remember what her name was.
I did not like that show at all.
It was awful. It was a terrible show.
that was a cringeworthy show. This might be the one where people are like, what do you mean you didn't like the Parkers? I mean, I still stand firm on not liking Anita Baker. Throw away her whole catalog. And also, there are not two episodes of the Parkers that I say we absolutely need to keep. Like, just... And that's not... You know, that's not to bash my Baltimorean sister.
That's right. Shout out.
Like, why am I blanking? Monique.
Name? My bad. I thought you were going to say it. That's the reason why I did. No, my bad.
I did come. Well, you know why I couldn't say it? Because I caught the tail end. This is us getting really cultural in this moment, but I caught the tail end of BMF last night at the season finale or something. Yeah, I'm not watching concurrently. I'm over that show. Yeah, but I saw her at the end of it, and I was just like, it's another one of those where it's like this catalog.
Oh, that's right. She was in the season. I forgot about that.
All right, back to us being only children, man. Yeah. So, like, we consumed a lot of the American nuclear family unit via television, right? Seventh Heaven, all of those other shows that we're
noting. You love Seventh Heaven.
I really love Seventh Heaven.
That's your
Camden
show.
The Camden family was my this good, wholesome, white American family, quite Christian American family is what. Yeah. Right. But
that show would never fly today.
They had a dog. I have a white dog as well. I am trying to construct my life. Yeah, man. I'm Pastor Eric Camden out here, man.
That's so funny.
Seventh Heaven.
I knew it was coming out. He does this very frequently, just so you know. This is his show.
That song is jamming, man. The 90s had, what would be our theme song if we had to pick, like, our brotherhood, my brother and me? Dee Dee and Alfie, shout out to them. So what would our theme song be if
they had a sister
come in here and do that every week? They did have a sister. All right, no, you don't even have to come up with a theme song because we come up with one every week. Did you want a brother or sister?
Oh, I wanted a brother.
And then we went to Morehouse and inherited a bunch of them, right? It was the best
decision ever. Proverbs 18:24.
Yeah. We got a ton of them through that. I'd say that very seriously, too. That Morehouse experience is how I learned brotherhood through that. And one of the things I said to you via text, kind of going back to Riyan, is that pretty much all of the fun things about me and all of the way that I engage with you through friendship and brotherhood is because Riyan taught me how to have fun and how to be a kid that enjoyed life rather than being as neurotic and by myself all the time like I was. Mm-hmm. So you learn so much about how to interact with others in the world through that kinship, friendship, and brotherhood or fraternity even, because that's a thing, right? We didn't pledge an NPHC organization, but we joined a fraternity by going to Morehouse, and that brotherhood just taught us just completely different bonds of what being fraternal meant in a way that I could have never understood as an only child. So it was worth the money, if for nothing else, to give us so many brothers, man. It's like, oh, this is what brotherhood is like. And this is what it's like to take care of someone and can't, like, it was beautiful.
I think that's why we love homecoming so much. Like, I think that's kind of like, you know, it's like the watering hole. Like, it allows for us to kind of come plug in, get that recharge, But yeah, no, that was a special experience. I mean, and it almost didn't happen for me. Like, I almost went somewhere else. I'm just so happy I made that decision. But yeah, yeah. To your point, that by itself, I mean, we got a bunch of things from the school, right? But like that by itself was worth its cost of admission.
Absolutely, full stop. So in this realm of only childhood, and you talked about it earlier about just you could talk to a wall. Mm-hmm. And obviously we've talked about having a mastery of linguistics and oration on the podcast before. We've talked about how we are naturally just leaning into gifts and talents that we have here. But I'd like to believe some of that to what you're saying, and being an only child, it's an interesting aspect of only childness that if you're not talking to a parent, and to be like, I'm not a parent yet, but I can imagine as an adult who has talked to children, talking to kids isn't really fun, right? So especially if you don't have a sibling to talk to.
We're high schoolers like on,
right.
on Thursday, so I'm with you.
So and even if you're a younger kid than that, by about age 12, you're getting in middle school, you're engaging in the world with politics and things like that in different ways. You can have a certain level of conversation, but those early convos, if you don't have a friend in the home, or, you know, your sibling in the home, your parents, like, I have to talk to my kid, but like, I'm not having fun about it. Right. Or you're around a lot of adults.
I was just about to say that. Yeah, that's a good point because I mean, I grew up with my grandparents. So like I was around a lot of older people. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. I think that's also part and parcel of, you know, growing up a little faster or, you know.
You never had the kids' table to go be at in our own home. So we were just within earshot.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. For sure. No, I mean, you're absolutely right. I don't think I gave that enough thought.
Because in my only childness, I have a lot of time to think. So that's all I've been thinking about. It's like, what was it like being by myself for 35 years? Like, as I write my memoirs. Yeah, just along those lines of just being alone with your thoughts, being alone with your own voice. Mm-hmm. One, so around inner monologue. And the question is, do you have inner monologue was what we were talking about earlier. You didn't quite know exactly what I meant. And I was like, well, let's hold it for the podcast. So I'm asking you on air now, do you have inner monologue? And essentially inner monologue is the voice in your head. That's the simplest way to say it. But you'd be surprised as a person. So what the research is showing is that and this is what I read today was referencing a 2011 research done by a psychologist. So, I mean, it could be updated for sure, but it said that only about 30-50% of people, and I don't know if it's the statistic, the people that they were using as respondents, but 30-50% of people in the study perhaps said that they had inner monologue, which if you extrapolate that out, and that is true of all society, that's shocking to a person who has inner monologue because it's so unique and native to you that you're like, well, what do you mean you don't have that voice inside your head? And so one example that they gave is people who subvocalization is what it's called. So subvocalization is when you read a book, are you reading the words in your voice in your head?
Yes.
Yeah. And I was like, how else do you read?
Apparently yeah, people I was going to say, do that. I was going to say, like,
but that's the thing about
Jackson's voice.
That's the thing about internal monologue. I think I've been saying inner monologue, but that's the thing about internal monologue.
It's like intrapersonal, like communication kind of.
Yeah. And because intro would be within between network. Right. Mm-hmm. They've got inner monologue, which some people refer to as inner dialogue, but same thing. And that dialogue even is different. Now, I've talked about this before, and you know, I don't know if you know, but you'll see it when we come out here on Monday. In my office, I have my own tweet printed out and put on my board, on my whiteboard, and it says a lot of people will hear their own thoughts or will hear directly from God, but say to themselves, no, that can't possibly be God telling me to do this. It must be my own thoughts, and put space between their thoughts and God's voice. So I've done a lot of personal research and searching and reflection over the concept of voice and inner monologue or dialogue. And specifically, like when I know I am talking to myself often in my head, this sounds like all the voices in my head, right, y'all? But I'm talking to myself often in my head, but there's a difference between my voice, God's voice, and the voice of wisdom to me. Mm-hmm. And the voice of wisdom is my voice, right? And we're not even talking about a trinity or triumvirate in this, but the wisdom is still my voice. It's the voice of my experience, my knowledge applied through experience. So, you know, wisdom is knowledge applied through experience. And when it's the same, it's the same exact tone and voice, but the direction of the communication is different. So, and it comes with action words. It's like, you must. And I'm like, why am I speaking like the Bible? But it's me talking to me, right? But it's like, you know, we need to, you must stop. You need to stop doing this. You should, you should avoid this. And when it's saying you versus the other voices, like, come on, Zan, like, let's, like, there's a difference in that dialogue versus, it's changed. Sorry. So
they use different words.
Yeah, they do. Different tenses, right? Subjugation, all
tone is different. But, yeah.
But so to that point, though, there are people. So what's your thought on inner monologue and the fact that there are apparently there are 50-80% of people do not have it?
Yeah. To me, again, when, even when you say, I mean, of course, you're going to bring the data. I love that about you.
A data point, though, right? It's not, I don't want to blow it up. It's just one data point.
No, it's fine. But I mean, it's going to ground the conversation, which I appreciate. It's weird to me that people don't have that because I don't know a life without that. You know what I'm saying? Like, I don't read in other people's tone of voice. Like, it's weird to me that even ask that question because I would have never thought to ask that question because I assumed everybody had that voice in their head.
And I don't know that it is around the tone of voice when reading thing and the sub-vocalization. So one of the things they were saying is that it impacts your ability to speed read because you translate the word that you're seeing into your voice first in your head before you. So I imagine that they're just reading. It's just words. It's not their voice or whatever. And even as people who podcast, they were saying the inner dialogue, inner monologue aspect, if you have it, it makes it even more difficult to hear your voice on a recording type of thing.
I hate listening to my voice.
Because it does not really sound like the voice that you hear talking to you all day.
Damn.
Right? Yeah.
We just got hold on. That was layered. That was nuanced. I appreciate that. Because again, I've never given this that much thought. Yeah, you broke down some walls, my man. I appreciate that.
So with the inner dialogue, and it's my inner monologue and dialogue are so important to me. And that's why I seek time alone. So I find it, you know, I open up talking about mellifluous and cacophonous, right? I find the cacophony of sounds too overwhelming. It's legitimately too overwhelming for me at often. And I have to, like, that's why I love these headphones. Not going to plug which type of headphones I'm wearing, but the noise cancellation on this is different than I've ever really experienced. And I can shut out all of the other sounds. It's like, okay, it's just me in the room with my voice now, because I was so used to having that abundant time and allowing me to process through those thoughts. And when you get everything else coming at you and you're overstimulated, like, not the only children have a harder time existing around a lot of noise and people, because we got to cultivate our quiet often.
Yeah, as two kids that grew up in Brooklyn.
Yeah, well, I mean,
the irony is hilarious.
White noise to me.
But I feel you. No, I feel like, oh yeah, absolutely.
It's weird for me to live a place where there is not a bus coming by.
That's right.
Like, that's strange. Yeah.
I mean, we talked about
ambulance
it when you were
sound.
Here. It's so quiet here. Yeah. It's so just like, but also
that was the scariest thing
I've ever gotten.
Yeah, you know, I actually, and maybe this is more just to my life being a little more chaotic and dynamic and always having movement in it. But when I go places and it's completely quiet, so, you know, I go to the desert by myself. I've been.
Yes, that was my next thing. Yeah.
Yeah. Like, I've been. So, yeah, the solitude is so important to me. I will go literally be in the desert to just be the only person there.
Right.
I was sitting.
Tell people about that process that you know, because you are
an
outdoorsman at this point, right? Like, you'll go to the lake, you'll pray, you take that time. Like, you are literally a character from the Bible. So, like, how do you, like, talk about that? Talk about the need. Talk about how that is tethered to your younger self and that need for solitude and space and time to think and be intentional in all of that.
So I'll just start here. I do a lot of abundant solo travel, although those were redundant words, but I do a lot of solo travel, and I find solitude really important for my thoughts, back to that voice. And now this sounds like a purely evangelical podcast, and that's not what the intent is, but, you know, if anybody wants to learn about how I live my life and try to seek righteousness, we can do that. But,
it's better than a cultural podcast talking about John Moran. That's all I'll say.
Yeah. We're not going to go there. So I find it easier to be in the presence of God when I know that there is not another soul nearby, or I can feel as if there is not another soul nearby. I feel like
you can focus.
I got God's direct address, just me and you. Mm-hmm. And so where I go to pray at the lake, I go at a time before anybody else is there, and just closing my eyes and feeling like, okay, it's just me alone. And I'm really big on the desert moments and, mm-hmm. and that isolation, because you learn to, the desert teaches you to sustain in a different way. And you realize what abundance looks like when you're around nothing but arid land, but everything's still living and breathing and not dead. So it's just beautiful.
That was good.
Yeah, this is one of my favorite places in the world, is to be in the desert, and specifically the Mojave Desert. And I guess the Joshua Tree National Park sits between both the Mojave and the Colorado Desert. So it's really cool with the terrain and different types of trees you get from the different atmospheres. Or environments, but
told you.
I hiked across the desert at sunrise. I had never done it before, just because I saw a far off mountain, and I'm like, well, there was a main road going through the national park. I'm like, I could be on the road, but then your moments of solitude are interrupted when a car does pass by. It's infrequent, but it will happen. Mm-hmm. So how far away can I get where I feel like it's just me alone, and then just me and God? And what it does is the solitude helps you to realize, you know, that you're not the only, like, there are literally 9 billion other people on the planet at the same time as you. But what you realize is, damn, God was so, maybe 8, I maybe skipped ahead.
It's still more than the 6 that I'm used to programming in my mind.
I think we're at 8 now.
Yeah,
but
that makes sense.
You know that the other, you know, 7 billion people out there exist. But because you are alone, you found one space to be alone on the earth in that moment, and to know that God was able to care enough to create you so uniquely that you exist here on this plane in that space and time, it does something different for being present. It does something different for being mindful. And I feel like that removal from all of the other people helps me to really know what's my purpose here. Who am I? I need that solitude. And I think I know myself because I've spent time with myself, and a lot of people are so used to the noise or haven't had the opportunity or fear spending time with themselves. I think that's been a benefit of being an only child is, well, if I know anything else, that's, I know it. Mm-hmm.
Yo, let's talk about that, because that is paramount. So I agree with that. I agree that that's why the pandemic was so shifting emotionally for people, because it forced people to be by themselves there was no place to be. You couldn't really go anywhere in the early days of the pandemic. And so it forced people to have to deal with certain things, being in their own solitude. It was forced solitude.
You know, yeah, I thrived. Yeah.
Me too. But you know what I'm saying? Like, because I also believe that, like, you're much better at this than I am, but you've cultivated your home space in a way where it's like, I don't really got to leave the house if I don't need to.
Yeah. Well, see, that got strange. I think that comes from
my childhood, where I'm just like, I want everything I need to have in this house. Mm-hmm. So I don't, and I've turned into you at this point when it comes to that. Like, I don't, because I have so much space now.
Yeah,
you
people know Zan doesn't leave home.
No.
It's a lot for
me to
leave.
He's tethered
to
this room that he's in for
and
the most
I've
part,
been,
creating.
I mean, I've been 100% virtual at work since September of 2019. So that's, I was right, 100% virtual employee before the pandemic. So right, when it happened, I was like, oh, go time. Like, I'm in the zone now.
Time,
like,
to shine.
I know nothing. If I know nothing else, I know how to do this. And then you add in the fact that we built a home gym.
Right.
So I didn't have to go to LA Fitness. Everything I needed was here. But what I realized,
I'm
still working through this in the backyard. Feels like it was clubbish. So if I wanted to go out to a lounge, right, I could just have champagne here and just all of that stuff. Right. So,
hammock time.
But what I've been ruminating over, toying with, right. And I'm still working through this concept, but as I thought about Riyan's experience and the experience of anyone that I've known that's been in prison, and I think about, like, even though I've brought everything in house, I started feeling imprisoned. Mm-hmm. I started feeling like, okay, I have everything that engages me. And obviously we understand, especially given our guest last week, we understand that I have a lot more luxury and an opportunity to luxuriate than anyone that's been in prison. But even so, I was like, well, I'm not engaging with others. And I was in there's solitude and then there's solitary confinement. And although I could do everything I needed to do in this home, it was like, well, I'm only engaging with computer people all day during work. Mm-hmm. If I don't leave property and I just don't go outside and get sun and engage into that other side of being an only child, I was extremely exploratory because I was alone. So I'd just be outside by myself, not making a ton of friends, just like I'm in the dirt, I'm in the woods, just getting into stuff, just nature stuff. I've always been that kid. So my mind needs to be engaged. Mm-hmm. And the monotony of seeing, even though I've got a bunch of different things, that's why I keep buying new toys, because mentally I need constant engagement because I had no one else to engage me. So I had to keep, like, it's just, there's a mind thing there. So I go to LA Fitness now daily because I'm like, well, yeah, I could work out at home, but I need to see other, and I don't talk to any of those people. I talk to the front desk person. She likes my clothes often. I say, thank you. I like whatever hair change she's done. That's it. I don't want to talk to anybody else unless it's a guy like, how many more sets you have? And eventually people from my gym will be listening to this podcast. Hopefully everybody that asks me, I'm always going to tell you two. I never know how many I have left, but I'll end it in two sets if you come and ask me. So how many sets you got? Two. So it's always what it is. It's always two. I've been BSing and I have no clue how many, but if I get two right now, it won't take too long for you and I'll get enough.
I feel like I got something done.
I felt like I thrived, man, but also there is a headwind to that tailwind. But I know
I did the same.
Similarly. Yeah.
I did the same during the pandemic. I spent a lot of time on my bike, as you remember, riding around Brooklyn, getting in the shit, exploring and all of these different things, parts of Brooklyn that I didn't even know was redone and looked different and all of that. But like, that was my exploration during that time. It allowed for me to be stimulated, obviously. So I can relate to that a lot.
Do you feel like it's easier for us, and us as only children, I mean, specifically, to do things alone?
Absolutely. Cause you know me, like I'll pull up to a Chelsea bar in a Chelsea jersey and sit down at the bar and watch the match and eat a burger.
But you're also a gregarious. Like, see, there's a caveat here, because you go to the place alone, you know for a fact you're never going to be alone the whole time there. You make friends everywhere you go.
I do.
Talk to people everywhere you go.
I do.
I want to go be alone, and I'm like, don't engage with me beyond
I don't go to
the
those
normal
places
level of courteous. Yeah, but you just find it. It finds you.
I mean, you're not wrong.
I've ever met you somewhere, he's like, I'm just here alone. It's like, well, by the time, if it's 10 minutes between the time you say, come meet me at the place I'm alone, you have a friend and a half in a 10 minute. Like, that's the return. That's the return ratio on you. Like, a friend and a half every 10 minutes. It's crazy.
That's a good point. And then, again, only child. Like, I've been like that since I was a child. Like if my mom was here, she would tell you that I will go to the park, or she'll take me to the park. And I have a picture, maybe I could find it in one of these albums, where in the park, I come back, my mom, check in, because you know, you go to the park, you come back, check with your mom, make sure you're good, whatever. She's like, yeah, you got X amount of time left, cool, so go, you know.
You ever got a beating for not making that time?
What'd you say?
You ever got a beating for not making that time?
Oh, yeah. Have you met me? You just said it. So I made friends, I'm having a good time, I'm not ready to go. I mean, or not coming home when the street lamps come on. So, yes.
I'm thinking of a beating so bad that I don't believe should have been as bad as it was. But to be honest, like, you know, we grew up at a different time. We didn't know it is what it is. But the fact that it's so real in my mind and in my physical form right now, it's like, man, I just was like a couple minutes late with the street light. Like, and it was like, you heard me outside. You could have just came and said, come inside. You let me miss it. And then be like, it's so crazy.
No, I got it from my mom. And, you know, my grandma was, I mean, at that point, I mean, she was not, I mean, she wasn't a disciplinarian, not really anyway. But we had that respect. Like, I respected her as an adult figure. So it was like, okay, I don't want to let her down. But she would stick her head out of the window and be like, okay, it's time. That's how the kids on the block knew me. Yeah. They knew my grandma by her just belting out my name in the window. But yeah, I mean, I am that person. That is true.
What did kids call you when you were growing up? Did they just call you Stewie, anything like that?
Stewie.
So, all right. Do you think we would? So, you know, I like to give myself nicknames. So you just slid a nickname in there. You know, I mean, give myself
Mouse in the 40s, man.
I hear you, man.
He's 48th Street, baby.
Listen, that's Stu giving you his street cred rap. You know, in my street, when they knew me in the streets, his mouth from the 40s, baby. Hey, man. Back in my day.
From the 40s.
Running up and down till that, till Nav, you know me.
Till Nav, baby, to the park.
Anyway, man. So you just blew up my whole question because I would, you know, I never really got nicknames, man. I felt like if I had a sibling, they would have given
me. I know,
I
tried
to give myself nicknames. That's why I sign in with a different nickname every week. Like, I'm going to be who I want to be. But, you know, just along those lines of going out, we talked about the meeting friends. We talked about a lot of the what we valued in our being only children. But I guess my question is, what do you think were some not so great things or traits, behaviors that we've inherited as only children?
Here's a great one for me. And this is one that I alluded to earlier in the episode, but I don't think I finished that thought or circle. So this is great to close that loop. That feeling of being alone. That is something that is one of those what got you here won't get you there things. Mm-hmm. Because, you know, when you lose your primary figure parent, in my mind at 12 years old, I'm thinking, okay, well, the person that was going to advocate for me the most is now gone. You are on your own. You have to figure out things on your own. And this goes back to the financial stewardship episode as well, where I was very risk averse because I knew that the wrong decision could land me in a place where I have no safety net. Mm-hmm. And I kept telling myself that up until maybe like 2 years ago, where I was like, well, but that's not actually true. Like, if you fell on hard times tomorrow, you know, your bonus dad would have you, Zan would have you. This list could go on and on.
Numerous. Is what I'm supposed to say yes or no to me having you? Like, people Sam was quiet in that moment. I'm just kidding.
I'm not worried about you. I'll just show up at your house.
Like, what? Sam was real quiet when Stu said he would have him, man. They must have beef on the podcast.
No. I got Zan's
own beef.
I got Zan's door code.
So you want to start our own beef, man? So we can have some drama so we keep going?
Yeah, I mean, what are you, 50 Cent? Yeah, so that's a thing that I had to like really like come to grips with, like, yo, like, you've been telling yourself this for years, but it's actually false. It's categorically incorrect. Like, there are people that would have you should things go left in your life.
So
yes, I think that comes
you
from
see me smiling because I'm hearing everything you're saying, and I agree that's not true. But where I am is you telling people you have my door code, and my mind just went wild. Like, now I got to know that if somebody holds Stu hostage to try to get the door code, you can keep it. Like, now I either got to, so I'm going to just change it and give you a new one when you come on Monday, because I'm like, I don't want people trying to, I just ideated so far out. It's like, nah, this is a risk.
What are you, James Bond? Like, hey, man, like who would capture in what Zan's so, door code?
So
too much homeland, man.
Okay, so too much homeland. Not too much homeland. It's, I mean, there's a lot of reasons why that paranoia exists.
That's fair.
But and shout out to Abu Nazir.
Abu Nazir.
So there are a lot of reasons why that paranoia exists, and I don't agree that the paranoia should exist, but I'm just calling out that it does. And
fair.
If nothing else, if I had a sibling to tell me during the years that you should know what you're thinking is crazy, then maybe I would have had some balance. But left unchecked, that's where I am. We got to make sure that nobody holds you hostage to get the door.
Did we not have this conversation about how you have all my passwords, more or less, or my password recovery tools because you know so much about me?
Yeah, and also it also speaks to the fact that we kind of make too much money individually for us to be sharing accounts still for all the things we share. Like, I don't have Spotify.
That's true.
And remember when I used to log in and be like, oh, you listen to music right now, man? My bad. You really need to listen to it?
That's so funny. He's like, but I'm painting right now.
Yeah,
I'm painting right now. I mean,
man, cooperative economics, that's what it is. Yeah, I appreciate you making space for my gifts and on your Spotify. It's cool. I don't really need it. You know, I'm trying to set
Apple
the mood.
Music going away these days.
Yeah, nowadays I am. But there were days when I was trying to paint and I started playing some weird stuff. And Stu got on the bedroom boom boom playlist for the ladies. And I'm like, oh, Stu is doing something different right now. Look how we spend our Saturdays very differently in our youth.
Sure. Thank God for
then
growth.
I ended up with the text message like, oh, I see what playlist you were playing, bro. My bad.
That's sick.
That's visibility. But that's what I imagine, right? That's true brotherhood. If you were in the house, I'd imagine people with siblings, their siblings have all of their real intimate details and passwords and all that stuff. And then we recognize the value of it kind of late, right? Yeah. We spend our whole lives not realizing, oh, this is what it's like. It's just like stepbrothers. We are very much like, oh, we even better. We got them when we were 20. Like, you know, we were happy to have Night the brotherhood. Hawk. Yeah. Well, I thought Riyan last week was going to actually start the phone, and this light beaming on my face right now looks really weird. But I was hoping that Riyan was going to start the call last week. Yo, Kemosabe, because he always says Kemosabe when he joins, and it makes me think about stepbrothers. But man, just the ability to
you
have
use that
someone
a lot too. You use Kemosabe a lot. I don't think a lot of people know where that comes from. But go ahead.
You mean the movie or the native language?
I know people have heard Kemosabe, but don't know the reference per se.
Okay. So, you know, what's also cool about us being only children and establishing a brotherhood with one another later in life. Mm-hmm. You've not heard all of my stories yet, which is crazy.
No.
You would think you have, and
that's
vice versa.
Point. Yeah.
Right. So if we were in the house, you'd be like, well, I mean, yes, I was there with you. Or I remember mom and dad said the same thing that day. But there are things that. So now I'm kind of giving a preview of a future story to be told on the podcast. Did you know that I tried to rap in high school at the Renaissance Fest? I did rap.
I did not know that.
Just listen to all I just said at high school in the Renaissance Fest.
Art high school.
Yeah. So we said we want to do a high school episode. We're setting the groundwork for the fact that we were only children in high school. Mm-hmm. We had to go out and make our friends there. Mm-hmm. And then so what you all get in me daily is the weird kid who was already weird, was always by himself, and then went to art school to incubate that weirdness. So it just gives, if nothing else, a lot of context into why I am fully who I am today. But we'll talk about that story when we get into the high school one, because it's going to be wild. And well, you probably be like, I wouldn't have been friends with this kid.
Maybe not. Maybe not. I mean, I can't even imagine. I mean, I think I've always understood your love for music, I think, is on another level than a lot of people. So that's one. That kind of makes sense. That allows me to draw a dotted line, but I wouldn't have guessed that. But even the
iceberg
story.
My uncle was a rapper too, right? Yeah,
that's fair.
My uncle rapped. So, and his album was number 3 in Spain. Let me shout out Jared True Luck, R.I.P. in this moment, man.
Number
his,
3.
His producer. His producer. Only behind Reasonable Doubt.
Wow.
See, when you put that benchmark
that's
against
impressive.
It, it's
oh,
like,
yeah,
okay, look.
Impressive.
Hey man, shout out to Mark Boogie Brown, his producer. So I have a question, and I'm looking at the time here as well, but you know, we still are unfathered. What do you call the guys without kids? I was trying to say a cool way to say it, right? But we're not parents yet. And I look at the age we're at, cause my mom was a parent at 21. I don't recall when your mom became a parent, but
26, 20.
Okay. But so 26, 25, way younger 26. Than us.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Yes.
And while we talked about that, hey, I was the eldest child until I wasn't. It's quite possible now at the age that we're at that the children we do have may be only children. So how does that resonate with you, really? Unless you roll twins on the first roll or whatever, but how does that how does that resonate? And you know, you could plan however that stuff's supposed
not
to work.
Her,
I ain't never planned no kids,
been.
But right. Yeah. Maybe you could plan to go back to back and all of that, but 36 years old, I'll be 36 this year. It's quite possible that it does not work the way that we thought it would.
Yeah.
How does that, what do you think you would impart on an only child? Or how do you think it will shift the way that you love on your only child, knowing what that was like for you?
Wow. That's a very poignant question. I think, reaffirming that you're not alone, you know, ideology, I think when they're kids, but I think that our structure is kind of set up that, you know, and this is my hope, obviously, that we would have children around the same age group that allows for them to be able to, feel like they have siblings, or at least cousins that make them feel like, okay,
sibling cousins type of things.
Yeah. You know what I'm saying? Cause that was a good thing for me, was that I had a lot of cousins. So it didn't,
and
it
I
didn't
did not.
Always, and you did not. That's right.
Yeah.
So that allowed for me to be able to build those relationships. And
I didn't have a first cousin until I was 11.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's late.
Yeah. I only have, so my, that's the other thing. And I think I missed that. I'm sorry. I cut you off, man.
No, go ahead. No, this is important.
And maybe this would be part of my answer, because so in my family, a big thing that affected me in my only childhood was that in very real ways to me, at least, I felt as if I had a burden mm-hmm. of my existence being somewhat messianic. And what I mean by that is mm-hmm. my family's really, really small to begin. Mm-hmm. And there had been a lot of loss in generations before me that took away the men in my family. Mm-hmm. And like my mom's dad was murdered when she was 4 years old. Then his brother died 6 months after that. So her grandmother lost both of her male children, lost her husband, all that, only had my mom. Then Zan gets born. It's like, okay, we got an heir. We have a man. Like they looked at me like I was the Messiah in some ways. And that burden of that was really tough throughout my whole life because we only have Zan to focus on and all of his extended siblings and my great grand aunts and all of that. They poured a lot of love into me, mm-hmm. but also there was so much attention on me. And I've always felt an extreme amount of pressure. And mm-hmm. then I get a first cousin, it's 11 years later and it's a girl. So it's still not that same type of dynamic yet.
Yeah.
So the first grandson, the only grandson still to this day, and all of that stuff, just there was pressure. Yeah. So to my child, whenever that happens, I would eventually, and if that child is an only child, to what we're presuming right now, mm-hmm. I would certainly want to alleviate the burden and the pressure of being the only in any ways mm-hmm. that I can. And some of that is the being alone.
Yeah.
Some of that is the just setting them up correctly so that it taking care of me isn't required when I'm old and all of that, yeah. like in the same way, you know?
Oh yeah. But that's big.
Encouraging, that's big. Like we said, the values of partnership, encouraging them to go and get someone to help them when you realize right. early on. And I think my mom had always said that, like, look, it's only you. I want yeah. you to go and find a wife. Because it is only you need someone when these things. So she had really adult my conversations with me early. Right. Yeah, it makes sense. Yeah, right. They no know question. They yeah. recognize the constraints and the restrictions and like this is where we're headed. So let me tell you what I want you to do. But
that's real.
That direct, I will try to mitigate the burden I place on them, I guess I'll say. And not that and I perceive the burden to be real. I don't know if the family placed it, but I'll do everything I can to be like, hey, kid in the future. You don't have to feel like you got to deliver us. You don't have to feel like right. all the attention. Like, yes, we pour into you. We love you, but do your thing. Right. It just, there's something there where it's like, well, I'm the only person everybody's focused on. I got to give everybody updates. It's just, you got to find
I felt that too.
Yeah.
I agree with you. I think that was probably the best way to say it. Is that burden that, I mean, maybe burden might be too harsh, but that pressure to achieve, which
it's
we talk
pressurized responsibility.
That's right. That's mm-hmm. right. That's right. That's right. Because I felt that, but for different reasons, right? Like, hey, your parents came to the States, had you in the States for you to succeed. Mm-hmm. It's incumbent upon you to be able to fulfill that goal. You know what yeah. I'm saying? And we talked about the role that achievement plays in our life and how it kind of grounds us and makes us feel like we are, you know, doing what we need to be doing. Right. So I agree with that. I think there's absolutely something there.
Imagine you got a field, you only plant one seed in the soil and that's the only soil to grow. I mean, that's the only foliage to sprout from it. Right.
You need that harvest, baby. You're right.
Yeah. So that's what it feels like, right? Mm-hmm. I'm the seed of everybody's promise mm-hmm. that came before mm-hmm. me. Mm-hmm. And I wish that's they spread a little more in that soil because it's got to grow from me. Like, I've got to create a harvest. And, you know, we thank God for good soil from the families that came before us.
Now, see, that's your son.
That's good.
Gerard. Like.
So man, Gerard, anything in closing? I think that was a good note to close on for real.
Special mushroom. Yes.
Had it queued up. I win for today.
And Gerard had two parents, man. The only children though. As far as we know, Gerard was an only child. Look how weird he was. You know, I can't stand him. my discontent with Hollywood.
That is amazing. What a way to end.
All right, man, let's close out. I feel like if we were brothers,
yeah,
we would have been
brothers, but I feel you.
You know, but like grew up in the same house, came from the same womb type of thing, like some amorphous combination of like Sophlean, we would call our mom.
Sophlean. That's good.
So fresh and so fleeing. But I'd like to imagine that we're like Blank Man and Other Guy.
Oh yes.
I'm not gonna say which one of us is which, right? But we'd be Blank Man and Other Guy in our brotherhood.
This would be dead on if not for your discontent for the friends and for the other guy.
All right, man, play us out, bro. Back now you have a hard stop.
Hey, back it.
Come on, man. You said you got a hard stop. And other guy would be the big brother. This old Kanye, this is becoming an I Miss Old Kanye podcast.
My big brother was Big's brother.
Mm-hmm. Used to be Dan and Big's brother.
Who was the cop brother?
Who was no ID friend, no ID my mentor. And I let the story begin. It's the hard knock life to a sellout. Picture us in the mall, copping iceberg and yell out.
The beat sounds so good.
Yeah, that's what we yell out, yell out. You know the name, do I gotta spell out or tell about?
That's why all my clothes are cartoony. It's just honoring that inner child.
That's true.
I'm pretty sure we're way over the time limit of the song right now. Let the story